Irving Game of the Week is brought to you in part by Gerald Stavely Dry Cleaning.
From Irving Schools Stadium, it's the Irving Community Television Network Game of the Week. Tonight, homecoming 2015 for Irving Nimitz as they host the Bisons from Sunset High School. Hi again, everyone. I'm Rob Will and John Nelson riding shotgun tonight. He'll be joining me in just a moment. You know, when the 2015 high school schedule is released, the first thing the homecoming committee does is they trot down to Coach Brian Rogers' office and say, hey, Coach, find us a game at home that we can have for homecoming where the team is beatable. Well, tonight that falls squarely on the shoulders of the Bisons. Now, it's not a knock against the Bisons, but Sunset, they're just kind of in a community in a district that really just doesn't feed a lot of talent into their school system. They have to work for everything they get. And this year, these guys are really struggling. How much so? Take a look at these stats right here, and that kind of clears things up for you. Looky here. They've only scored 11 total points in four games while giving up over 200 points. 12 first downs, that's all they've managed, including zero in one game this year. The passing game is non-existent with only six completions overall. That's right, just six, and five interceptions. Last week against Jesuit, they passed for just 10 yards and rushed for minus 25. That's really disheartening for a school that's one of the oldest in the state. This is the fourth season for their head coach, Armando Gutierrez. He won two of three last year before district started, but this time around, he hasn't come even close. His roster is in a constant flux. In fact, they only have 30 kids suiting out tonight. This happens a lot when the kids just don't want to put in the effort. They start losing. They don't want to play. Many times, he has to pull from the sophomore team. He wants to keep the JV in check. Now, although the numbers may not be as strong for a lot of the Irving teams around town, Coach Rogers and the Nimitz Vikings, they have a good nucleus, and they've been playing better and better, including the running game. You know, just like that pro team from Arlington, when the running game clicks, so goes the Vikings. Last week, Mark Eugene got on track with four touchdowns and over 250 yards rushing. Look for a heavy dose of the running game from Eugene. And because he'll probably be so successful, and if everything falls into place scoring-wise, look for some fresh faces to see action tonight, too, including Eugene's backup, Cameron Henderson. Against R.L. Turner, Henderson scored on runs of 63 and 69 yards. So what does Coach Rogers see tonight as keys to the game? Well, just the basics. Hit the Bisons quickly. Don't give them any hope. Also, don't give anything away. No turnovers. And defensively, make it three and out for Sunset for an offense that really doesn't get first downs. You know, homecomings are fun when you win, and tonight really on paper, the Vikings really should win. It should be a fun night for both the fans and the players alike. So let's tee it up. It's the Vikings and the Bisons next on the ICTN Game of the Week.
And welcome back to Irving School Stadium. Homecoming tonight for the Nimitz Vikings as you see the Sunset Bisons take the field. Sunset, it's been a rough start. And here come the Nimitz Vikings averaging 31 points a game, 231 yards of rushing, and a 52-7 win over Carrollton R.L. Turner a couple of weeks ago to open up district play. Head coach Armando Gutierrez in year number four. Bisons have been shut out twice this year, and no easy task tonight here at Irving School Stadium. Sunset and Nimitz, and for the Vikings, head coach Brian Rogers hoping for a career win number 12 here in his third season. Nimitz in home blue, and the Sunset Bisons in a road purple with white numbers. As you see, Brian Rogers 11 up and 13 down. District 9-6A, and Rob Willman with a play-by-play tonight.
All right, John, thank you very much. Jose Aguilar, the sophomore, wearing number 81, will tee things up. Only the second time these two teams have met. And it might be the last, according to how the new alignment goes next time around. And Tony Dean watches that one go into the end zone. So the Bisons will just take it at their own 20-yard line. No time going off the clock as that one goes to the back of the end zone. It's a team that has struggled offensively. They don't have a lot of time to throw the football. That's part of the issue. They have a sophomore at quarterback. And tonight, they're going to stretch him out as a wide receiver. We saw some of this in pregame where they had Tony Dean as the quarterback. So Rosas is far sideline, and Dean will keep it from the quarterback spot, and he is wrapped up and thrown down immediately by Noah Spears. Spears first on the team in tackles. The senior with 19 solo coming into tonight's game. Let's give him 20 because he just broke right through the line of scrimmage and dropped Sunset for a loss of about 3.
Yeah, Spears and Jordan Stegman, two leading tacklers this year for the Vikings.
So second down, about 13 to go. Sepulveda is the running back, number 34, just to the left of Dean. And he goes in motion to the right, and just a little quick out and incomplete, almost a backwards pass. Coming across the line of scrimmage, number 6, Jordan Stegman, the junior, right on it. He'll be second down.
And the defense, the offense tonight for the Nimitz Vikings, Townsend, Yarbrough, and Sample. That's the Nimitz front three. Then Stegman, Ross Spears, and Franco, the four linebackers. And the secondary, William Jenkins, Perez, and Simpson. Nimitz allowing 18 points a game this year through the first 4 weeks.
Third down, clock stops at 11:13, and the quarterback Dean tries to take it to the right, wrapped up, might have got a yard, maybe not. Yarbrough, one of the first guys in there to make the stop, and it will be fourth down.
Well, Dean just trying to make something happen, trying to get to the edge, and the Vikings clogging up and making a tough running around that far side.
I can see the mindset of the Bisons offensively as just try to spread things out a little bit and try to get something going offensively. They have really struggled out, you know. It's almost to the point to where you have to just run all the time just to run some time off the clock. We've got, an illegal substitution.
That'll cost them 5 and move it inside the 20.
First penalty of the night.
Susan, on the offense, 5-yard penalty, still 4th down.
Raylan Lee's tonight official, he's the referee.
Calling that one, so going back to kick is Kevin Valerio, the senior, plays wide receiver and defensive back. Nimitz with about 9, high snap. Ball goes about maybe 10 yards, takes a backwards bounce, and is finally put to rest by Rosas, and Nimitz has great field position.
Yard, let's see, that's probably almost 5-yard punt. Where it was downed, it may be closer to 4. Here come the Vikings offensively. Here is the interior line anchored by Ian McClure. Guards and the tackles. Quarterback, running back, and receivers. 4 wideouts. Mark Eugene, the main ground carrier this year for Nimitz.
And they go to the basic set. 2 receivers, top and bottom. And they're going to throw right off the bat and hit number 15, Zach Wilson. Wilson struggles a little bit after the catch, but still manages 2 more on top of that on yardage after catch, about 9 in all. And Pena is 1 for 1. He really didn't light it up last week against Turner. Threw a couple of interceptions, threw about 50%. It was that running game that really took hold last week in the first district game. High snap, and they give to Eugene in the backfield, and he is wrapped up big time by Manuel Flores, one of the many sophomores on this team.
And a marked man denied, and Flores able to sift through almost untouched.
So it's 3rd down and a long 7 or so. Eugene clapping his hands to his offensive lineman, like, come on, guys, block me a little bit. And I would suspect that maybe Pena will go back to the air again. maybe look for Barry, although they do have help up top. There could be a free play here, and he's going to go deep. Yep, they called the play dead as he tried to hit Barry, his favorite receiver, but it was already second 5-yard penalty now assessed against the Bisons. That left defensive side, left defensive tackle moved across. There are six players on the Bisons roster, which is very thin, I might add,
third down,
that go and play both ways as starters.
Would you count 30 or 31 tonight on the roster?
30 on the roster. I think only 25 actually suited up, believe it or not. Handoff, Eugene inside the five. He's got a first down. And that's what you would expect from this Viking offensive line is open up some holes like that.
Yeah, Eugene on the year, 575 yards. A young man that ran for over 1,000 yards last year and able to bounce to the outside, and you just hope the secondary's there and have some help.
Eugene with 10 touchdowns so far this year, looking for number 11, first and goal inside the two. And it appears he is in for touchdown number 11.
So the Vikings strike first on a short 22-yard drive thanks to a 4-yard punt. And a nice homecoming start for the Vikes.
Indeed, as they will go to the swinging gate. Coach Rogers opting just to kick this one away. We will probably see a lot of players that we don't see very often, those that really work hard since two-a-days to be on this team and to be second on the list to get up and play. Extra point is good. And watch it again, John.
Just a straight hand off and follow the blue. Just follow the blue wave behind number 53, Ian McClure. And Aguilar boots home his 13th successful extra point on the year. Again, a short 22-yard drive.
Ochoa had an arm, but you're not going to bring him down with an arm tackle.
All Eugene did last week, Rob, 251 yards of rushing.
Yep,
what a
almost,
night.
Yeah, almost half of his yearly total, averaging over 7 yards a carry. And the Vikings take care of business, do what they should on the very first drive. And now Aguilar will tee it up again with Tony Dean, the first of three in the middle. There's Dean right in the middle part of your screen. And Beltran here to the near side.
Nimitz last week, 467 yards of rushing and 22 first downs in that 52-7 win over Tony.
And Luna was the third of those three receivers in deep formation. So it'll be the second time the Bisons have an opportunity to try to get something going offensively as Aguilar just kicks it away and into the end zone. And Dean will just look at that one, go back, and we'll see what's up here in the second possession for the Bisons.
Sunset, a team that went 1-9 last year, 0-7 in district. They only returned two offensive and two defensive starters. But they feel like they have a little more team speed this year.
And Coach Gutierrez is telling me he's bringing more sophomores up than he is JV players because he loves the nucleus he has on the JV. All right, Tony Dean remains in at quarterback. Has plenty of time. He's got a lot of time back there. And he plants a foot and falls and trips. Not a lot of size for Tony Dean. Got some quickness, but can't really see downfield there. And good job by the Viking secondary keeping things in check.
Yeah, he was looking for Fabian Rosas, number three, trying to get open down the far side, and then the running back, Sepulveda, open over the middle, but unable to pull the trigger.
Only three rushed that time for the Vikings. They decided just to let him run around a little bit. Breaking the huddle, Ochoa now slotted to the right. Two to the top, two to the bottom. And they give it to the running back to the right side, and he is just met immediately by the linebacker, big number 9, Noah Spears.
First team All-District last year, led the team in tackles a season ago.
Sepulveda, the running back, who had a pretty good time of it in a couple of games. He goes to his right here, but here comes Noah. No one touched him, and he just used his strength against Christian to drop him for a few yards loss. And it's third down and long, not a situation that's very friendly for the Bisons here. Dean flush from the pocket, got some running room, twists and turns. A little shy, might have picked up 7 or 8 on the run, but he's going to be down 3 yards shy. And more than likely, the Bisons will punt it away.
Well, that's what they need on first down. They need a ground-gaining effort on first down, really, to hang with the Nimitz tonight.
Yeah, they have no business making it 3rd and 10,
right?
3rd and 8. They need 3rd and 2, 3rd and 3 at the most. Trying to see if they change punters. We saw 2 before the ball game. Valerio and Hernandez, and I believe Valerio is back again. High snap, plenty of time. He just drops it straight down and has reverse spin on it. The Viking players, number 10, Brandon Ross, getting out of the way of that one. And it will land square on the 50-yard line. And that's where the Vikings will pick it up for their second offensive possession. That last possession took about 4 minutes off the clock.
Pretty close to it.
Believe it or not.
Nimitz 1-1 at home this year. First week of October on a homecoming Thursday night.
Pretty nice outside. Just a nice gentle breeze coming out of the north, northeast. Motion man, they give it back to Eugene. Eugene for 10, 15, 20, sidesteps a runner. Gets about 25 on that carry. Nicely done, Mark. You'll be padding the stats tonight for sure.
25 over the left side, and a nice hole opened up quickly by Marcel Jones, number 74. Kind of skates down the sidelines and turned it downfield for another 4 yards.
Yeah, Jones did a good job, number 74. Yeah, the rush is on, and Pena is going to be dropped. Well, there are some shining moments for this Bison team. Ochoa there. Also some help from Daniel Hernandez, the junior linebacker. Well, they just said, we're coming all out. And it appeared they were trying to set up the screen, but you can't let everybody in that easy. And Manuel Flores, the sophomore, big number 76, we've called his name a couple of times tonight. For the Bisons, he pretty much came in untouched. If you're going to call a screen, put a shoulder pad in there at least and slow him down. So now it's second at about 20. Back to Eugene. Eugene dances right, cuts left. He's about a step away. Got 11 yards of those back. And Nimitz not shy at all. If it's 3rd and 20, we'll still run it. Watch Pena there to your left, now right in your screen blocking.
Yeah, leading the way as he moves aside Gabriel Luna, number 12.
All right, 3rd down, 8. Vikings at the Bison 24. Bisons threaten blitz. 2 safeties deep, and they're just going to go to Barry. Barry in the corner, pushed away against by Dean. Barry's got a size advantage there on the corner. Here's the call.
Penalty remains 3rd down.
So another 5-yard penalty against Sunset. Their 3rd. 2 defensively. Got a couple of sophomores on that D line. Rivera also playing defensive line, number 73. So it's 3rd down. Eugene in motion. He goes back, and let's see if they do the dive play again. It's worked well. Nice hole. Breaks the tackle at the 17, down inside the 5, and the Vikings are in business again, 1st and goal, as Eugene reels off another 20 or so yards and They're making it look easy between the tackles.
First down number three and another first and goal from the five. Oh, look at that space.
Oh, man, just a nice block by number 74. He talked about Jones earlier. Jones, again, with really good work on the offensive line. First and goal. Less than 4 minutes to go in the first quarter of play. Norris goes in motion. They go to his side. He's got it. Touchdown.
Cody Norris, his first touchdown catch of the year. And for Pena, who comes in with a 65% completion rate, and that was easy. I mean, you and I could have thrown that little short pass.
Yeah, I really could. People think not, but yes. Yes, I could. And a good job for Pena because he's had some, like we said, some interception woes. And this gets the touchdown up there on his side, a little bit higher ledger of more TDs and interceptions. So that little trail that works so well when they come out of the slot, and a wide receiver Barry, who seems to grab all the attention. Barry clears the zone as you take a look at Barry there, and Norris, number seven, came in for the touchdown, and just like that, the Vikings are on top 14-0.
Touchdown pass number five for Joe Pena. 671 yards entering his homecoming match.
We talked about Marcell Jones and how well he's been playing on the offensive line. He came in tonight's game as the number two guard, right guard, but he's been playing a lot of left tackle and left guard here in the first quarter. Be a lot of fresh faces. I got an idea here pretty soon. We'll be seeing some new guys in there defensively on the line as well, getting some playing time.
So you're saying they should put their helmets on right now?
Why not? Your helmet should always be on. Well, I guess not.
Oh, it's homecoming. You want to look good.
All right. Jose is going to be busy kicking off tonight, I believe. This time he's going to force a run back. It goes over the head of Beltran, and lucky for him, it goes into the end zone for a touchback.
Third possession for the Bisons here. A little less than 9 minutes remaining in the opening period. 14-0 Nimitz, or 15-0 Nimitz. Interesting way to cap off their second drive, just a easy pitch and catch on the goal line.
That came dangerously close to Sean, our sideline camera guy.
I was looking at him all the way. Yeah, it was.
Look out, Sean. Whoa. Good steady job. Meanwhile, back in action here in Sunset on their first down with positive yards, about three, by the quarterback, Tony Dean. Dean getting some starting action at quarterback.
It's his fifth carry already.
So second down in about seven. Gabriel Luna, one of those guys that plays two ways, is out to the near side. And they tried one of those little quarterback flare passes to the running back, and the running back, Sepulveda, he just, I don't know if he heard footsteps or what Sepulveda did, but he raised the ire of his quarterback right there, number 10, Tony Dean, who showed his displeasure after the throw.
Well, it was a good idea if it's caught, trying to get some isolation, but you can see the coverage closing in quick.
Yeah, Brandon Ross breathing down your neck. Ross third on this team in tackles with 10 solos, 11 assists. And they got a guy coming across, broken up nicely by number 25, Cameron Henderson. And you know what? Right there for a second, I thought Van Horn might have had a couple of steps, or Luna had a couple of steps on Henderson. And Dean just waited just a little bit too long to throw that ball. If he'd have thrown a little sooner, I think he might have had it. But he gave a lot of extra time for Henderson to catch up and threw it behind Gabriel Luna. So another punting situation for the Bison. They're short a man.
Back deep, number 16, Sam Berry.
Yep, Sepulveda had to come off the bench there. And they kind of go light on the punter and let him kick it. Barry looks at it. And they start about 5 yards further back than they did last time they had the football. This time at their own 45-yard line.
How about field position, the first three possessions for Nimitz? They start from the Bison 22, they start from the 50, and now their own 45.
Yeah, when your own 45 is the deepest
starting
point.
You know, I'll take it.
Yeah, you know things are going well, don't you? All right, let's see what Mr. Pena tries to do, if it's going to be more of a steady dose to Eugene, or he's going to throw it some. Well, he's going to look for Barry. And Barry gets his catch and is knocked out of bounds pretty close to the yard marker needed for the first. The corners aren't very tall for the Bison. And we know Barry has some good size to him here on the corner. They could really exploit that as he has to go against Dean, and a lot of time for Pena to let that one go, John.
Yeah, Barry comes in averaging 19 yards a catch.
That one was good for 9, second and 1. Bison's crowd the front line just a little bit. And Eugene keeps the legs churning. Good for 4, good for another first down.
Just straight ahead. As you said, keep those legs pumping, keep them churning. And don't get short change at all. And he won't before this night's over.
Sunset hoping that they go down in classification next year to 5A. Still have some tough teams in DISD to face in 5A, though, with South Oak Cliff and company. A little down and out. Barry makes the catch and pushed out of bounds again by Dean. Almost enough needed for another first down.
Quick out. Barry's third reception.
You know, they have a lot of kids in the band. They've got a lot of cheerleaders, a lot in the drill team. The numbers just don't reflect that on the football team. Second down in a couple. Rushes on. Pena quick out again to Barry. They're just making a living working on Dean here on the corner. And everybody's stats will look good tonight for the Vikings. It's very easy, it seems, for Pena and Barry just to play catch out there as Barry just drives the defender as far as he can and just runs a hitch.
31 yards on 4 catches already for Barry.
And Pena delivering right on the numbers there. Let's see if they go back to the ground. Nope, going to throw again. They had Norris, there's Barry, wide open. As that time either Dean slipped or just got faked out. I think it's one of those plays where perhaps Barry tried to run the hitch and go and Dean went for it. He bought it, and Barry goes in to score the touchdown unmolested, and the kicker comes back out for the extra point.
We're going to hear that fight song a lot tonight, aren't we?
We are.
55 yards on that drive.
Aguilar's extra point. Looks good from this angle, and it is. So, with 2 minutes and 2 seconds to go, Nimitz up 22-0. Looky here, all by himself, Mr. Barry.
Wide open. And
see, he just ran right past Dean.
Oh, he was hoping somebody in the secondary would come in at about the 10-yard line and provide a little help, but they were invisible, nowhere to be found.
Well, again, one or two things happened there. He thought he was going to do a hitch, and he did a hitch and go, or he thought he had some deep help, but a safety was going to come across and pick him up in the zone, but that was not the case.
Is this night done? Is Barry?
Yeah, you know, I think these guys will play for 2 quarters perhaps, and we could see Jared Jenkins transition over from defense to quarterback. That's a possibility. Cameron Henderson could come in and do some running in the second half. We could see some of the guys that don't get to play in the wideouts like Reyna, Howell, Barbosa.
Hey, it's a late September call-up. It's a pennant chase.
It is fun down at Arlington right now, isn't it?
Oh, it's done a complete 180. since July.
The kick into the end zone.
This is an NFL game. No non-returnable on the kickoffs. Never see a return in the NFL anymore.
You don't, do you? Just let them take it at the 25 and go on.
Or kick off from the 20. I mean, the guys are so kicking 75 yards in the air. I mean, 75 in the air.
I still say the width of the goalpost need to come in some. Make it interesting. I still like the adjustable goalpost.
At will, just whatever you.
No, it's at a different. You know, if you're closer, the goalpost width it goes smaller. If you're farther away, it goes back to normal. You know, just make it a little more interesting. All right, first and 10 for the Bison. A little quick hitter out to the near side. Dean fumbles the football.
Vikings have it.
Yep. Dean to Luna. Luna number 12 had about 3 or 4 yards on the quick hitter, and when they went to tackle him, the ball came right out of the basket.
Jonathan Horta there on the sidelines. He had about a half a yard to work with. A little safety valve pass, little screen pass out of the left flat.
To Luna. Luna broke one right there. Looks like that number one, Michael Perez, knocked that out. He didn't put the ball away. And I guess, you know, some bright spots for the Bison. They're, you know, making some positive yards that they have not been doing, but you know, this is a team that can't make mistakes.
Cameron Henderson, now the tailback.
Yeah, we thought maybe the third quarter, but how about right here in the second quarter? And all the way down to the 5. Cameron was just licking his chops waiting to play. And you can see that they've got another guy in the stable that can do a good job. He's just a sophomore. Watch.
20 yards on a quick opener. And it's first and goal.
Caught from behind. They're going to give him grief about that in the tape room on Saturday. Good thing for the Viking coaches playing a Thursday game. They can go scout on Friday.
Yeah, there's some good news and bad news in playing on a Thursday. It's a short week, but then you can scout your next opponent.
Henderson breaks the tackle. Touchdown.
Almost pulled down at the 2. And able to run out of the tackle.
So, 2 handoffs and a score. Scored a couple last week. That is his 3rd touchdown of the season. Had 183 yards coming in. He's over 200 for sure. Extra point. Looks pretty steady, Eddie, from here. Count it, and it's a 29-0. Nimitz lead, still the first.
Touchdown coming just over a minute from the catch by Berry. And Henderson's first rushing touchdown.
Credit the right tackle, Eric Cisneros, with a really good block. Paved the way for Henderson as the right tackle just pushed the D-line toward the center. And that gave Cameron plenty of opportunity and space to take it outside for the touchdown. At halftime, we'll have the announcement of the homecoming queen. We'll be introduced to the queen and her court. And all the good fun that happens during the homecoming of 2015.
Well, 52, the high watermark offensively in points this year for the Vikings. Well, almost, they're halfway there.
Nimitz won last year 42-7. They're well on their way to picking up 42 points again this year.
Oh, it's just a beatdown here in the first 11 minutes.
Says my right leg is sore. Kicking it off into the end zone. They put another receiver in the middle instead of Dean. They had a Luna. Same results, though. He just let that one go into the end zone. And here come the Vikings again out defensively, looking at some of the starters, seeing if we got anybody new out there. We do. Jalen Williams playing at one of the tackles.
I think Martin Morales on the D line as well.
Yeah, Martin Morales. We have not seen Martin before.
Well, you're seeing him tonight.
Yeah. We are. A lot of fresh faces.
In the secondary, you got Lance Rhodes.
First and 10, they continue to go with Dean. Give it to Sapula, and he is racked up right at the line of scrimmage. Made that mistake of trying to jump about the time he jumped. Big number 10, Brandon Ross, is there to wrap him up and end the play with no gain.
Jumped into the arms of Morales as well. Aguilar, Aguilera there.
Making the most of their time out there defensively. Also, Andrew Jones playing on the defensive line here on the near side. Second down and 10. Dean, with plenty of time, goes across the middle and almost intercepted by Lance Rose. It's like, ooh, I'd like to have that one back again.
A thing,
a coaching moment.
Yeah, it hung up there, and any trio Vikings could have had it.
10-yard pivot from the previous spot.
Yeah, the receiver had fallen down, and Rose was in great shape. There was a holding call on that play. And I guess the Vikings will go ahead and take that and back the Bison up. That's what about their fourth penalty, I think, of the night.
Let's see, four penalties for 40 yards.
So it's second down and 20. Sepulveda is still back in the backfield. They fake to him, and Dean comes right up the middle. He's got some room, 25. A good shoulder into him by Rose.
And
he picks up about 15.
Brought down by Lance Rose.
And so it'll be third down and about five.
Dean with his sixth carry, and now some positive yards after being trapped behind the line a couple of times.
Yep. You notice how they, when they line up, the offensive linemen just stay in one spot.
Yeah, they don't move.
No. And then the receivers, they never come to the huddle. They just, there's three of them, and they all just gather on the far side. Ochoa, one of those three. Vikings put about five guys on the line of scrimmage. They try to give it out to Rosas, and I don't think he will even get to the right line of scrimmage. In fact, he'll lose a couple of yards. Nice pursuit by the Vikings. Ross and also Simpson, a couple of those players.
Pass complete to Fabian Rosas.
And that's going to do it to end the first quarter of play. Our score, Nimitz 29, Sunset nothing. Back for the second quarter in a moment. And we're back to the start of the second quarter. And Sunset gets off a pretty dandy kick. So close to being blocked. Lance Rose came in there from the blind side and almost got a piece of that. Somehow Valerio got that one away. And I believe this is the deepest now that the Vikings have started. They keep going back. About the 32, their first play coming up, first play of the second quarter.
Fifth possession in the first half, and what do we have?
Well, we got Jared Jenkins now in at quarterback. It's going to be Jenkins and Henderson. Again, it's that combination I thought would really take place in the second half. Also, Chase Rogers being split wide out here to the near side. A lot of those star players, their night is over, but not for Henderson. Henderson, 10-15, breaks two or three tackles, and another at the 40. We got a flag, and I believe we're going to have a clip or something against Nimitz, I'm guessing, back here at about the 43.
Run of over 65 yards, and Henderson is down.
I think he just might have had the wind knocked out of him. He took a pretty good tumble there toward the end of the play, but he's back up. But we'll wait for the official to give us the ruling.
Flag drop near the 40-yard line of Sunset.
Well, block in the back, number 80 on the offense, 10-yard penalty for for the spot of the foul. Still be first down.
Barbosa called for the flag. Get ready for Barbosa hitting him right from behind.
Rule of thumb, if you see the number, hold up. You can't go ahead and throw the block.
Hold the bus.
Well, he went down hard, didn't he?
He did. Took a tumble. But let's see if he's back in there or not. No. Apparently, I think Derek Hamilton, another one of those young guys that Coach Rogers has up. Hamilton now in the backfield with Jared Jenkins.
That was a run officially of 15 yards and a first down. First down number 8 for the Vikings.
Let's see if they go to Hamilton or out for a couple other receivers. Rainier's in there, number 11. And talking about Barbosa. Hand off Hamilton. Hamilton up the middle. He makes a nice nifty move. Hamilton across the 30 down to the 29-yard line.
27 yards on that pickup.
Derek Hamilton had 17 yards coming into tonight's game. If that penalty hadn't wiped out that long one, he'd had about 50 or 60 already by now. So Hamilton's in place of Henderson, who fell pretty awkwardly after a long run. And I see him with his helmet off down on the sideline. He still looks like he's okay based on how he's walking. Yet to see Jared throw the football, but we may see that happen in a minute. Nope, go back to Hamilton. Hamilton had a nice stiff arm. Juke move at the 15. Cuts against the grain at the 5 and touchdown.
Hamilton takes it 29 yards and the 5th different Viking to score.
Derek Hamilton with his first touchdown of the season. And it comes at the homecoming game at the expense of the Bison. And going back to kick will be Aguilar. He's adding to his point total as well. Extra point. Looks good, and it is. Looks too easy, Mr. Nilsson.
Well, Hamilton, 2 carries. He has 56 yards, and it's not going to chase him down. Sidesteps the defender at the 7, gave him kind of a turnstile look, and let him go the final 6 yards.
Sepulveda was the first one to have a shot at him, but after that, everyone really had bad angles.
Here, you take him. I don't want him.
Yeah, Beltran, he didn't have a very good angle after being blocked, and Hamilton makes it look easy, and so do these Nimitz Vikings. You know, the district season starts where they have games that they're supposed to win, and apparently they're going to win those first 2. You got to win the ones you're supposed to. If not, it's an uphill battle trying to make postseason.
68-yard drive. And again, Hamilton, the 5th different Viking to score in the first half. Mack and Irving, our ICTN Game of the Week next week. And the play times this week as well. Tigers and the Cards. Mack won that game big last year, a couple of years ago. Irving took the game en route to a 6-5 postseason year.
Yeah, that game will be played time-wise tomorrow here at ISS. Football falls off the tee. One of those doubleheaders for us at ICTN.
2 for the price of 1. A day night, a twi night.
Let's play 2. All right. This time just kind of pooch it a little bit. And almost almost fell in Henderson's hands. He is mad at himself for not catching that ball.
He overran it.
He did. It went a little bit too far. Went out of bounds. And Sunset will take over.
Really giving the Bisons a chance to start at a decent spot on the field. Their own 40, their best field position. Punted 4 times and they fumbled.
Well, let's see. We've got Williams in now at one of the tackles defensively. We have Damian Torres playing the nose guard. Andrew Jones playing on the other side. Dean says, do I want it? Well, I'm going to try. We'll flip over to number three, Fabian Rosas, sophomore. Number three, he took it pretty good hit back in the second quarter. Yeah, watch Dean. He didn't know really what to do. Looked like a la Brett Favre, but just not quite as successful as Favre would do sometimes.
It started towards a line of scrimmage. He wanted to run the ball, then he kind of stopped and shoveled it up there ahead.
Sepulveda just to the right of the quarterback, and the quarterback fakes, keeps, goes to his left, wrapped up nicely by Ross. Man, that is like the fifth or sixth tackle that Ross has been a part of in this ball game, and I think maybe Dean a little slow getting up, and why not? He's taken a brunt of all the damage defensively.
That's his seventh carry. 8:18, and that clock is moving. You saw it first, didn't you? No stoppage here from on rest of the way.
Luna split wide to the near side. More substitutions defensively. Stegman will go out, and Carter Franco, one of the linebackers, he goes in on a third down and 11. And they just swing it out. Sepulveda gains about three on the play. But it's not going to be nearly enough as the punt team goes back out. And really, the Bisons don't have a lot of guys on the roster. And so for them, just having Dean hang in there to stay at quarterback, he's going off top of your screen there, right about the 40.
And nobody's back deep for the Vikings. Nobody in return posture.
Dean looked like he didn't know where he was at, and they don't have enough players out. And very quickly coming out from the sideline was Victor Acosta to fill in the void on the line, and the Bisons having to call timeout. About 7 minutes to go before intermission. Standings in the district play. We talked about having to win early. And those that did last week, really the top four that won are what a lot of people are predicting will make postseason: Jesuit, Nimitz, Skyline, and MacArthur. White might have something to say about that, but in the early stages, the top four all won their games.
And the top three with a combined record of 9-3. That's kind of following the line on what all the predictors had back in August. And they're ready for about 8 minutes to take their homecoming positions on the field. Big night here at Nimitz.
Vikings looking for their third straight homecoming win. R.L. Turner, the victim last 2 years in a row. Nice little punt. Gets inside the 10 and will rest right about the 8-yard line. So it's the little victories that you'll take with you as Valerio, the punter who had just terrible kicks back in the first quarter. He had a much better kick now.
Well, they got him pinned back deep. They got him where they want him, at the 8-yard line. And a whole host of new numbers as well.
Well, at the running back, we've got Hamilton back in there. Hamilton says, I'm going to make the most of this opportunity to run the football. And a quick snap to Jenkins, and Hamilton goes right up the middle. One of the referees, boy, got crunched up. Hamilton gained about 9 or maybe 10 on the play. Not a good time to be the referee right in the middle of the play. That's the most dangerous part.
That's $70 right there.
Oh, at least. They could have made it themselves. You know, that's a thriving market in itself, buying all the parts and pieces and customizing yourself. They give him the first. First down at 10. Real quick out. Oh, through the arms of number 80, Barbosa.
First and completed pass tonight for the Vikings.
So it's second down. Wide receiver split to the near, and you know the Vikings can take all the time in the world. The Bison have added two extra defenders at the line, so there's really no one playing deep safety. You get past that first line, you're going to do well. And he breaks one tackle, and he's got a lot of room to run. Down to the 50, and Hamilton pushed out of bounds at the 45. There wasn't a lot to go with to the right, but then Derek changed his direction and was just a whisker of breaking that one.
37 yards on his fourth carry. First down number 12. They've already piled up double figures in first down. And is anybody coming to the picture with a white jersey? And they do. This is come flying by. Fabian Rosas.
Hamilton, he stays in the backfield. Jared Jenkins just basically spinning and turning to his right or left and handing off to Hamilton as we're about 4.5 minutes left here before the half. And here will be his first attempt to pass, and he slips and falls. Yeah, they're going to credit 76 Manuel Flores with the tackle, but all Jared did was try to get his feet underneath him, maybe run or plant for the throw, and lost his footing, and that'll go as a loss of about 5 yards on the play. Barbosa, Reina, Howell, and trying to get a number on that far sideline, number 22, Chase Rogers. Those are your four wideouts for Nimitz. And they're going to go to Rogers, and Rogers dropped the ball, hit him right in the hands.
Nice pass, perfect pass. Hung it on a line, and now it's third and 15. And the clock continues to run.
Chase Rogers, one of those second team Z-backs. And a slot back. Playing on the far side, and here's the color coding.
I like the middle, I like the yellow.
You like the yellow? You going with that side?
Mm-hmm. Putting it a call.
All right, third down. Pena waits and completes and might have a first down as Rourke Howell, number 12, made a nice route, a little down and out, knew where the yard marker was at, and gave pretty good effort. They're gonna call him about a yard shy. He's making some moves there back to his quarterback. Like, almost had it. I should have stretched it out just a little bit more. So fourth down in about a yard. And the Vikings will use up all the time on the clock to let things pretty much extinguish itself down. Why not give to Hamilton? Hamilton's got first and maybe more. Hamilton's going to score. And the Vikings are on the board again.
34 yards right up the middle. And Hamilton closing in on 100 yards now.
Hamilton says, I'm gonna enjoy this running ability here. Giving my chance to get out and score some points for my offense. Hamilton, Henderson both. And remember, folks, those two were both sophomores. Both the second string running backs as the extra point is missed. Both Hamilton and Henderson both just sophomores, so we've got a couple more years for those guys, and they're the future of the Nimitz Vikings offense, at least on the ground.
Yeah, ground-wise, you're right. Five sophomores listed on the varsity roster. That took completed a 92-yard drive. That drive started from the 8, and Hamilton, somebody just laid a hand on him as soon as he got the handoff on the shoulder pad right there, and that's it.
Well, credit Garcia, number 63, Brian Garcia, and Alfredo Vieira, number 50, on the left side of that line with some good blocks. They opened up the holes. Got Hellman on man and created a really nice hole for Hamilton to run through.
Oh, I was a little off. Hamilton, 5 carries now, 138 yards, and 2 touchdowns.
You know, I heard earlier tonight that Irving School Stadium press box voted the 2nd best food for the media. Now, you will say, not so fast. You're going to put us down at number 3.
I'm going to put, Cedar Hill ranks right up there. Dunkville's good. But this one, the food's delivered before kickoff. Some of those, it doesn't come till halftime.
Ah.
That's the key.
There is the key. Tackle made at the 21-yard line.
GW has those Sonic burgers and those cheese poppers and those onion rings here at least 30 minutes before kickoff.
Stegman making the tackle for special teams there. Down in Cleburne, they make some great chili.
Wow. In September?
Yeah, it's kind of their staple. But it's good. It's good chili.
Yeah, Cedar Hill has an upper level and a lower level and a buffet line on the first level. And if that's not enough, got chili and pizza and barbecue.
Dean, across the middle, complete and good enough for a first down. It's number 81, Jonathan Auburn. And he's a junior. Doesn't usually start. But a bright spot there for the Bison here in the first half.
That's our first down and a 12-yard pickup.
Well, Alboron got behind the linebacker. I don't think they, meaning Nimitz, expected Dean to throw it. And he's going to try it again, try the exact same play. But instead came over here to Rosas. And he's pretty close to another first down. Yeah, this is going to be their 2nd first down, 2 in a row for Sunset with 16 seconds to go before the break. Clock begins to roll. I mean, nothing fancy. Dean just trying to find somebody open. And Rosas was there in the flats, and that is going to do it for the half. So we finished a half of football. Our score, Nimitz, 42. Sunset, nothing. We'll be back with the halftime and the crowning of the homecoming queen coming up. Stay with us.
John Nelson back with Rob Willman at Irving School Stadium. It is all Nimitz. First 24 minutes as they lead it 42-0. 5 different players. And with the extra point, really 6, getting into the scoring column in the first half as the Vikings kicked off. And Sunset started with an own 25 and then proceeded to punt it away. As you see, the Vikings here at homecoming as they're spread out from the 20 to the 20. And let's go down to the field.
Are Senior Lieutenant Maria Monzone, Captain Lindsay Duchesne, and First Lieutenant Sabrina Pena. The Vikings are celebrating their 45th anniversary, the legacy of gold, 1971 to present. We would like to take a moment to recognize the Vintage Vikings for their continued support and participation. We can't wait to celebrate and create memories with you all this year as we celebrate 45 years of Vikings tradition. Welcome home, Vintage Vikings. Welcome home. Ladies and gentlemen, for your homecoming halftime entertainment, the Vikings are performing a colorful routine to Let's Get Loud. Thank you.
42-0 here at Irving Schools Stadium. The homecoming activities taking place here at Nimitz as they ran all over the Bisons here to begin the play. A short 22-yard drive following a sunset punt. Eugene takes it in from 2 yards. Extra point, good, 7-0. That came with 8:28 to go in the first quarter. So starting at midfield, Pena finishes off that 50-yard drive, hooking up with Norris. 2-point conversion made it 15-0. And then a 55-yard drive on this 25-yard toss to Berry. That came with 2:22 to go. 22-zip. It goes 29-0 as Cameron Henderson goes in from 5. That completed a short 23-yard drive. Then a 68-yard drive culminates on this Derek Hamilton 29-yard run on the outside. Stays in bounds. That coming at the 10-19 mark, and Hamilton from 34 yards right up the middle, untouched. That capped off a 92-yard drive. Extra point good, 42-0. Five different players for the scores, and that's where we stand. All Nimitz as they came in averaging 31. The Bisons came in surrendering over 50 a game. They've been shut out twice and en route to possible third shutout here on this homecoming night.
Good evening. My pleasure to introduce to you our Nimitz High School 2015 Fall Valhalla Homecoming Court. Our court consists of 3 freshmen, 3 sophomores, and 3 junior princesses. Our senior group consists of 5 senior princesses and 5 senior princes. They will be introduced to you in alphabetical order by grade level and first name. Our first freshman princess is Miss Alyssa Dubose. She is escorted by her father, Michael Batchot. Alyssa loves tumbling and cheerleading. She helps with the Lamar Middle School cheerleading squad in her free time and likes working at her family business, Joe's Family Restaurant. Our next freshman princess is Miss Jenna Scoggins. She is escorted by her mother, Jan Scoggins, and father, Brent Scoggins. Jenna likes photography and music. She hopes to one day attend law school. Our last freshman princess is Miss Madison Sanchez. She is escorted by her father, Mario Sanchez. She loves to play volleyball, cheer, and spend time with her family. After graduation, she hopes to attend Texas Tech University. The class of 2019 princess is Jenna Scoggins. Next, we will introduce our sophomore princesses. Our first sophomore princess is Miss Alyssa Villa. She is escorted by her father, Jose Villa. In her spare time, she enjoys listening to music, dancing, and spending time with her family. After graduation, she plans on attending Baylor University and becoming a physical therapist. Our next sophomore princess is Miss Madeline Banda. She is escorted by her father, Steve, and brother, Lucky Banda. She likes to play soccer and spend time with her family. She plans to become a medical doctor specializing in plastic surgery. Our last sophomore princess is Miss Paola Martinez. She is escorted by her mother, Maria Fraga, and her brother, Pablo Martinez. After graduation, she hopes to attend the University of Texas at Austin in order to become a psychologist. The class of 2018 princess is Madeline Bonda. And now our junior princesses. Our first junior princess is Miss Jennifer Garcia. She is escorted by Mr. Brian Pollard. Her hobbies are going to concerts, reading, listening to music, and hanging out in the band hall. Her favorite subjects are math and English. She plans to attend college after graduation. Our next junior princess is Miss Katie Parada. She is escorted by her mother, Angela Ferrafino, and sister, Jasmine Parada. She loves running cross country and wrestling. After graduation, she wants to go to college to become a doctor. Our last junior princess is Miss Miranda Diebrick. She is escorted by her father, Brian Diebrick, and grandmother, Anda Hitt. Her hobbies include playing volleyball, cheerleading, and riding motorcycles. She hopes to attend Oklahoma University, major in biology, and become a cardiovascular pediatrician. The class of 2017 princess is Jennifer Garcia. Finally, our senior princesses and princes. We start with our senior prince, Akil Abraham, escorted by his mother, Suja Abraham. He wishes to be a participant in a preliminary acceptance medical school track to further his aspirations of becoming a pulmonologist. He serves as the 2015-16 student council president and spends his free time doing volunteer work. Our next senior prince is Charlie Chavez, escorted by his mother, Reynalda Galindo, and brother, Juve Chavez. Charlie wants to go to college, graduate with a criminal justice degree, and become a detective. Our next senior prince is Jonathan Mahoney. He is escorted by his mother, Patricia Rodriguez. Jonathan plans on attending Boston University and majoring in psychology. Our next senior prince is Noe Ariza. He is escorted by his parents, Noe and Jessica Ariza. He likes to dance and make money. After graduation, he plans on going to Texas A&M to become an electrical engineer. After college graduation, he plans to enlist in the Navy. Our last senior prince is Adziti Hernandez. He is escorted by his mother, Maria Campos, and his sister, Nezeth Hernandez. He is a member of the varsity cross country and soccer teams. He serves as the president of the class of 2016. We will now introduce our senior princesses. Our first princess is Miss Esmeralda Cruz. She is escorted by her father, Javier Cruz. After graduation, she plans to attend the University of Texas at Arlington and become a teacher. She is followed by senior princess, Miss Jenny Guzman. She is escorted by her parents, Sonia and Manuel Guzman. Her hobbies are traveling, attending school sports events, and spending time with her family. She is currently a member of the Viking crew. After graduation, she plans to attend Stephen F. Austin State University and major in psychology. Next, we have Princess Miss Leslie Gonzalez. She is escorted by her father, Jorge Gonzalez, and her mother, Blanca Segura. She is a member of the Nimitz band and plays the piccolo. She is involved with FCC and junior historians. After graduation, she wants to go to University of Houston and major in criminal justice and forensic science. Next is senior princess Lindsay Hayden. She is escorted by her parents, Alisa and William Hayden. She has been a leader of Fellowship of Christian Athletes. She is the 2016 class historian and a member of student council. She has played softball all 4 years of high school. After graduation, she plans on attending Texas State University in San Marcos and getting her teacher certification to teach middle school. Our last senior princess is Maria Monzon. She is escorted by parents Jorge Monzon and Gladys Sosa. She loves to dance and hang out with her friends and family. She is in BICAs and serves as a senior lieutenant. After graduation, she plans to attend the University of North Texas. We will now have the crowning of the queen by this year's Grand Marshal, Miss Margie Stipes. She is assisted by Assistant Principal Ms. Wendy Trammell. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2015 Valhalla Homecoming Queen is Miss Jenny Guzman. Congratulations. The 2015 Homecoming King will be announced at the Homecoming Dance Saturday evening. Ladies and gentlemen, we present to you the 2015 Valhalla Homecoming Court.
John Nelson back with Rob Willeman on this homecoming night for the Nimitz Vikings. They lead 42-0. The homecoming queen, Jenny Guzman, has just been announced, that very happy Nimitz senior, and her court, princesses, and well-wishers on this first Thursday in October. Well, stat-wise, here's how things played out. The Vikings with 14 first downs. In the passing department, 5 of 6 for 56, 235 rushing yards, a total of close to 300. The Bisons held to just 2 first downs. They were 6 of 10 in the passing department, and a total of 53 yards. They were flagged 4 times for a total of 40, and they turned it over 1 time. 29 points in the first quarter for the Vikes, and 13 more in period number 2. We step aside, and we'll be back for the second half kickoff here with the Vikings on top 42-0 at Irving Schools Stadium on our ICTN Homecoming Game of the Week.
And we're about set for the second half of tonight's ICTN High School Football Game of the Week. Nimitz Vikings in control against the Sunset Bison. You see the three guys back in receiving formation. Dean, the middleman. Luna to his right.
Even though Nimitz kicked off to begin the game, Rob, they're going to give Sunset the ball to begin the second half.
Well, they decided to kick off both times. That ball stays in bounds. Luna, you got to do something with it. Man, he's lucky. Because streaking down the sideline was Cameron Henderson. And he was ready to pounce on that. That's a live football.
Oh, it went end over end. It went sideways and still stayed in bounds for a long way.
Beltran, number 2, just watched it roll. And Coach Gutierrez was telling his player, look, you can't do that. not when it's a live ball. So the bright spot for the Bison, man, the last series before the half expired, Dean was able to connect on a couple of passes, and, you know, victories are where you can get them, and they're very small for the Bison this year, and picking up a couple of first downs like that, that's a victory for this club. Moving the football is positives.
Trying to hold and control here for a couple of minutes to start the second half.
Jalen Williams, one of the three guys down up front. Low snap. Dean to his left. Henderson misses the tackle. And then a swarm of Vikings keep the quarterback from getting back to the original line of scrimmage. Man, it looked like someone just shot Henderson out of a cannon. He came across that line of scrimmage from the safety spot. And also Derek Hamilton. Derek Hamilton is in there. Both the running backs. My eyes aren't playing tricks on me.
Well, they are.
Both the sophomores are in there. Got some younger guys also playing the front line. Dean waiting, and he's going to go deep, throwing into triple coverage. And the pass is incomplete, trying to hit Ryan Van Horn at the Nimitz 40-yard line.
Well, but Dean had six completions in the first half and trying to hit one long here.
They're doing something the Cowboys were getting ridiculed for last week, and that's not throwing deep.
Hey, it was in the game plan.
Yeah. Can't do it.
Can't deviate from what Coach Garrett called.
He said we've got to stay by the book, stay the course. So Van Horn splits to the near side. Dean, he took a couple of good shots in at quarterback in that first half. Crossing pattern, oh, what a hit. Applying the pressure there was Mark Rodriguez, the junior. And Luna, who has taken a couple of good shots himself tonight, really got hit hard running that crossing pattern.
Just leveled him.
Yeah, Rodriguez, man. A great tackle. That was, you know, for the youngsters, those learning to play the game. He wrapped him up just like you're supposed to.
And again, nobody back deep for the Vikings. They want to have that clock run.
And we've got a whistle. Did the clock expire, the play clock, or was there some movement on the line? Let's wait for the official. He's mic'd. Now he's waiting for an explanation from his fellow Zebras.
Well, false start on the offense, number 63. Still fourth down.
Well, Joel Santos with the false start, number 63. So moving back an additional five. And he'll kick it again. And again, a nice tail dragger. He's gotten the punt has improved with every kick tonight.
Not bad.
No, not at all. Valerio, number 8, gets this one all the way down to the 20. Ball's down by Moreno, number 43, who also plays linebacker for Sunset. And a couple of nice kicks there.
Close to 44 yards on that one.
Yep. So let's see who comes out, if we have a third-string quarterback or not. It appears that Jared Jenkins will come back out. Barbosa is still in there along with Reyna, who are split to the near side. And then Rogers and Howell to the far. And there's our quarterback, Jared Jenkins. And we've got a new running back, our fourth one of the night, John. Jesus Cifuentes, number 46.
Also plays some linebacker.
Cifuentes, he's more like a fullback. I think Coach Rogers has, what do you think, pretty much called off the offensive explosion there?
Well, I'm looking down and watching all the players with their helmets off, and about a third of them are starters.
Yeah. A lot of them played just a quarter. I think she's out. He's looking at his phone, checking on the Rangers game.
They're trailing 1-0. Angels in command.
The dreaded Angels. Second down and about 9. And I think Jenkins and the rest of the group might do the same again. Well, a little quick hitter out to Rogers, and Rogers breaks the tackle and maybe close enough for a first down. Head coach Brian Rogers, it's his son, number 22. Chase all excited. Hey, I got me a catch. Made up for that one he couldn't handle in the first half. You know, that's what we do, coach, us announcers. We talk, we always bring out the bad, but he's having a good time, and everyone's having a good time tonight. It kind of goes back to the pregame show where we pretty much knew that everyone was going to get the opportunity to play tonight. And the Vikings need to enjoy this because things will start getting a little rougher as they work their way through the district schedule. See if Fuentes is met by a sea of Bison, but I've got a feeling they were offsides, and that'll give
Guerrero
5-yard penalty, first down.
They left a little early trying to blitz. It cost them five, and across a 30 here.
So rack up another first down for your Nimitz Vikings, winning last year 42-7 over the same Bison. You know, the Sunset, rich in history, but all of that was way back in the 40s and the 50s. That was their heyday.
Oh, there was a time.
There was. There really was. They have not made the playoffs since 2001. Drought's going to get a little bigger. See if Montez wrapped up right at the line of scrimmage. Their last winning season goes back even further than that. 1982, a year removed from college personally, was the last time this team had a winning season.
Well, they're the last state football team to win a DISD state championship. It wasn't Dallas Carter since they were stripped of that title in 88. It was Sunset. Last one, a state championship for a DISD school.
That Carter team was loaded in talent. Second down and 10. Cifuentes got a couple of yards before he's wrapped up by the big defensive lineman, Manuel Flores. We have mentioned his name, number 76, quite a few times. We're looking at Harry Marino, number 43. One of the linebackers. They play the three down linemen. Throw out four linebackers. An extra DB. Since Nimitz runs the spread, basically, but if you're not, they're doing a lot of running out of the spread. Here comes an all-out blitz. Rogers catches that and drops the ball and catches it right back. Oh, he's going to have fun in the tape room. We hit that one too.
Able to pick up 11 and move the chains.
Yep, good enough for another first down. Yeah, we meant it this way. Trying to keep his balance, and whoop, ball pops right out of his hands. So another first down. This is really the type of drive that the Vikings were hoping to put together here in the third quarter, really work on the clock. I mean, they've got the game in the bag, but it's just a matter of going through the motions. See if Fuentes wrapped up 34. Sepulveda having to play both ways. What about five or six of when the game started? Having to play both offense and defense. 25 suiting up tonight for the Bison. Be interesting, John, come February when we have that realignment, how the Irving schools will play out. They have really enjoyed this district and the opportunity for a lot of folk to make it to the playoffs, not just football, as you take a look at Jesuit Irving coming up in the future on ICTN. Hand off left side, maybe a yard.
Well, there's some early talk, Rob. I mean, that redistrict, it could stay pretty close to the same. It could go further east, or you could absorb two more schools. I mean, there's all kinds of theories out there.
Well, part of it, and this one for sure, is what happens to Sunset. Are they going to drop and go down to 5A?
you know, will we pick up Newman Smith? I think they dropped, and, you know, they're not here anymore. They may come up. It's all how that enrollment numbers and enrollment package settles in. Third down, Rogers caught, falls. He's going to be short. It's going to be fourth and about four.
Well, enrollment-wise, Sunset, almost 2,200. They're the smallest of the schools in the district. RL Turner's the second smallest.
You know, we have watched some of these schools now for the last couple of years. Turner has, I've seen, even though they're not top of the line, I've seen an improvement in their football team. White, a real big improvement in that football team. It's kind of been nice to see how those teams have improved themselves as Mata will do the punting, and going back to receive will be Luna. Vikings just content on letting that play clock just wind on down. There is about a 9-second difference between when they have to kick it and when the half expires. So they're going to have to kick it.
Yeah, this third quarter has just blown by. Two possessions total here in the quarter.
And the Bison's lucky they didn't get a flag there, because running into the kicker was Ochoa, number 44. And they may tell Julio Mata, you need to learn and pick up your acting a little bit and act like you really got hurt so we can draw that flag. Well, that is the end of the third quarter. Our score, Nimitz 42, Sunset nothing. Back with the final quarter in a moment. Big win for the Nimitz Vikings tonight. Homecoming, they pitch a shutout 42-0 over Sunset. Let's go down to the sidelines and John Nelson.
All right, Rob, with head coach Brian Rogers, 42-0, the Vikings on top on homecoming. Coach, a win is a win is a win. And in a way, it's kind of a hard game to coach, isn't it?
Absolutely. You know, that homecoming, you know, there's a lot of distractions sometimes. And we talked to the guys about having a lot of energy early in the game and coming out with a good tempo. Even though there's all this other stuff going on throughout the week. So I was proud that they came out and responded like we needed them to tonight.
Everyone that suited up tonight got a chance to play.
Absolutely, and that's good for everyone. You know, it's good. You know, they're day in and day out working just as hard as anybody else. So, you know, it's good to get those guys in and let them have a little fun too. Absolutely.
Mr. Hamilton and Mr. Henderson looked good early on the ground.
Our running game's doing pretty good right now, but they'll be the first to tell you it's because the offensive line's doing a good job. But, yeah, we have a nice little group of young backs coming down, so it's fun to watch sometimes.
Finally, Coach, you're 2-0 in district. Would you like to save some of these points for some of the games later?
Anytime you can get a win in 6A football, it's a good night. So we got some tough ones coming down the road, but it's good to be 2-0, and We'll go again next week and see what happens.
All right, nice job tonight, Coach. Appreciate it.
Thank y'all for being here.
Head Coach Brian Rogers has the Vikings win on homecoming.
John, thank you very much. All the scoring happened in the first half. It was pretty much everything was on automatic pilot in the second half. So we'll go back and look at the highlights. And the Vikings had control of this one from the get-go. Eugene, who had 62 yards on the night, scores a touchdown right there in the – the Vikings were well on their way. Norris, who only had one catch the entire night, made it count. Right at you there, folks. 5-yard touchdown catch, and the Vikings were up by a couple of touchdowns. And then to Barry, 4 catches, 51 yards. This one here, another touchdown. And then the guys come in off the bench. That is Henderson. Cameron Henderson had 3 carries, 50 yards, and a touchdown. And they went even deeper. They had like 5 running backs out there tonight. And this one here is Hamilton. And Hamilton had a great night. In fact, Hamilton had 136 yards and 2 touchdowns. He averaged 27 yards every time he touched the football. And a good night for Hamilton. So we talked about some individual statistics. Let's go ahead and break it down on how the teams fared And as one might imagine, it was a total domination by the Nimitz Vikings. You see the first downs passing. They both attempted about the same amount, but there's a big difference. Vikings had 110 yards, or the Bison only had 24. Total yards, 339 to 52. That pretty much tells the story. One turnover, Sunset with the fumble. Not a lot of penalties. It was, you know, not a perfect game in that regard. But for the Vikings, a win is a win. They're now 2-0, and they're in good shape as they hit the gauntlet with a couple of tough teams back-to-back before they face Irving, and then they have the Longhorns, and they finish off the year against the Cardinals right here on ICTN. Well, it's family night. I mean, homecoming is a chance to enjoy the past and think about the present and the future as well. Again, our final, Nimitz 42, Sunset nothing. For our entire ICTN crew, I'm Rob Willman. Thanks for watching, everyone. We'll see you next time on the ICTN Game of the Week.
Game of the Week has been brought to you in part by Gerald Stavely Dry Cleaning.